Yes, students, very good morning to all of you. Let us continue with our electrostatics. Today we are going to talk about the electric field. This is first lecture on electric field, and then we will continue afterwards. Of course, you should be aware of Coulomb's law. We have discussed in the previous class, as well as superposition principle.
These are the objectives of this lecture.
So let us begin. First of all, we should be knowing what is electric field. This term or this concept, I should say, was introduced by Faraday. To understand electric field, you have to relate it again with the gravitational field, or you can relate it with the magnetic field, which we will be discussing in the coming lectures. Because you have studied gravitational field in the previous class, so we can take that as an example at this minute. Like when you are here, you are able to feel the gravitational force due to Earth. That is, of course, the attractive force. So up to only a certain reason you can feel the gravitational field. If you are going beyond the Earth's gravitational force, you won't be able to feel the gravitational field of the Earth. Similarly, due to a charge, it can be positive charge, it can be negative charge, its effect can be observed up to a certain area, certain region, I can say. And that means I can define where I can feel the electric force or the electric field due to a particular charge. So the definition, you can write it like this, that the space around an electric charge in which its influence can be felt is known as electric field. The terms which we will be using in the coming lectures, like electric field intensity or electric field strength, again the meaning is same as that of electric field. Basically, electric field intensity or electric field strength, that is the measure of the strength of the electric field at any point. So before we go into detail of electric field, you should be aware of these two terms. One is source charge, another is test charge. So what is source charge? That is a charge due to which you are willing to feel, willing to find the effect, or I can say like due to the Earth. If you are finding the gravitational field due to the Earth, then the Earth can be taken as the source point with you. So source charge is that charge, that large amount of charge, I can say, due to which you are willing to feel it, the effect around it, that particular charge. And test charge is just to test the effect. Like when we are standing on the Earth, we can feel its gravitational field. So test charge is to be kept at that point where I want to find the gravitational field. Or I can say here in this chapter, we have to find the electric field at a particular point. At that point, to check the electric field, we will be putting a very small charge. That small charge is test charge. So two charges are there. One is source charge, another is test charge. Source charges due to which you want to find the electric field, and the test charges on which you want to study the electric field. Test charge is generally denoted by small q or q naught, and source charge is denoted by capital Q, or in many books it is given by small q itself. That is not the issue. Whatever you suppose, you continue with that throughout the whole thing. So this is, again, I have written electric field for you. That is the space or region around the source charge in which the force experienced can be observed. And of course, this electrostatic force, it is having the electrical origin, non-contact force it is, you all are aware of. Q naught is taken as the test charge. Like we have already discussed the force, this is the source charge. If this is point charge plus Q is the point charge, source charge, then at a particular distance, its effect will be same. So I can show it like a spherical body also. This is source charge, I want to find its force on this small charge, which is a test charge, then we have already done with Coulomb's law, I can find the force, which is will be given by K Q Q naught divided by R square, where if R is the distance between the source charge and the test charge. Then F can be calculated, and electric field, as we are defining, it is the force which is exerted on this small test charge. So I have to divide this force by the test charge, but you have to take care that here I have written limit Q naught tends to zero. It's not zero, but it is very, very small. The only idea is that the test charge should be vanishingly small. It should be having very small value. So if I can find the force using Coulomb's law, then I can calculate the electric field comfortably. Of course, value of ER, ER means electric field at a particular position, R here I have taken, that is finding the force on the test charge at that point. And it is the characteristic of the system of charges and is independent of test charge because you are dividing F by Q naught. So you will be left with KQ upon R square. So again, if your Coulomb's law is clear, you can write the expression for the electric field. Or another way to define electric field or electric field intensity is force experienced by a unit positive charge. Because if I take this test charge as unity, then electric field and force will be having the same value. Otherwise, in the previous expression, if I write Q value here, that will be cancelled by in the expression of force. And I can write the units and dimensions for electric field. Of course, we are using the bold symbols here to show you that electric field is a vector quantity. And its direction will be same as that of the electrostatic force. So if Coulomb's law is clear, electrostatic force is clear, then field is not any problem with you. You can do it very comfortably. Units, SI units are Newton per Coulomb. And if you want to write the dimensional formula, you know the dimensions of F, that is MLT minus 2. And you know the dimensional formula for charge also, that is 80. So I'm getting this as the result. So dimensional formula is MLT minus 3 A minus 1. And of course, I have already said it is a vector quantity. Direction is same as that of force. So we should be knowing what is its physical significance. It means what was the need of this introducing the electric field when we are aware of the forces. Of course, we are taking to help of electric field to help our imagination, because if we are like in gravitational force we have done, but then we have calculated field. So we are able to understand the things better if we are having this concept of electric field. We can imagine the things in a better way. And of course, we cannot see the field, but we can only experience its effects. Of course, it is a characteristic of the system of charges. I may have one source charge, I may have more than one source charges can be there, but it is independent of the test charge. So like we have done superposition principle in Coulomb's law, that will be applicable here. When I'm having more than one source charge, I can again find the total electric field using superposition principle. Of course, if I take it for a point source charge at a particular distance, if I'm taking from point source charge, it will be same in all the directions. So when it is same in all the directions, then it will be having the shape of sphere. Shape of sphere will be there, and that is why for a point source charge, I can write they are spherically symmetric. Again, the more importance of the electric field is there in the coming chapters when we talk about the electromagnetic waves, in which we will be talking about the varying electric and magnetic fields. It means magnetic fields and electric fields, they are varying, or I can say the charged particle is moving when it is kept in the electric field, how will it move, and how can I calculate the acceleration, and all those things that will be of course being discussed in the coming chapters. But there the physical significance is more, but you have to understand it now so that you are able to relate the things in the coming chapters. This is, I have shown you with the help of diagram also, if the charge, positive charge is there, source charge is positive, then as if I put the test charge here at any point, then it will be going in the outward direction. Because source charge is positive, test charge is always positive. Test charge Q naught or small q is always taken as positive charge. So it will be like charges, so repulsion. So force will be in the outward direction. So from the positive charge, always the force is in the outward direction. And if my point charge is kept anywhere at a particular distance in any direction, the force experienced will be same. If I'm having the negative source charge, then if I put the test charge anywhere at any particular point, then the direction of the force will be inward, like shown in the diagram. So it will be all sides, wherever you take the test charge, it will be coming in the inward direction. So the direction for the positive source charge is outward, for the negative source charge is inward. If I want to write the expression for the electric field due to a point source charge, then I have to firstly write the expression for the force. So here I have taken small q as the test charge. So force can be written as 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught capital Q small q upon r square, and this r cap is showing the direction. For the positive source charge it is outward, for the negative source charge it is inward. So when you have to write the this value force from the previous expression, you can write E it is equals to F upon Q, or F can be written as Q into E R. So E can be calculated, which is coming out to be 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught Q upon R square into R cap. Here R cap is the direction of the electric field, which is same as that of force. So direction of force and field is same. But if I keep this source charge in some medium, means the arrangement is there for the medium, then to take care of the dielectric constant, I have to multiply here in the denominator with epsilon r, which is dielectric constant, or you may write k. So my expression for the electric field will become 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught epsilon r, and then here it should be capital Q upon r square. The source charge, because I have taken capital Q. And here in place of epsilon naught epsilon r, if they have given you the permittivity as epsilon, then this whole expression can be written as 1 upon 4 pi epsilon capital Q upon r square. This is if I wish to write the electric field in terms of the Cartesian coordinates or space coordinates. I may take this point P where I want to find the electric field at any position. I may take it along the x-axis, along y-axis, along z-axis, if I want to go comfortably. Or if I have taken here at point P, then let me suppose that the coordinates are x, y and z. Then I want to write the electric field as I have written in the previous case. E can be written as k capital Q upon r square into r cap. R cap is the unit vector, which is in the same direction of the force, and field is also in the same direction of the force. So this much is clear with all of you. So now if I want to write this position vector here r, OP I have taken as the r vector, because then I can write it in terms of the coordinates like I cap x plus j cap y plus k cap z. And you can write the magnitude of r, which is square root of x square plus y square plus z square. This much you have done in your class 11th also. So here if I want to write the unit vector in terms of the given vector, I can write it because unit vector is given by the given vector divided by its magnitude. So electric field I can write as 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught q upon r cube into r vector. I am simply replacing unit vector with the given vector because I have the value of given vector with me. This is I cap x plus j cap y plus k cap z. And if I take E in the component form, if I write the electric field intensity, I am writing it as I cap ex plus j ey plus k ez. So it means I can write E in component form, I can write R also in the component form as here. So you can put the values and get the expressions for ex, ey and ez simply by pairing the things. So ex, obviously it is along the x-axis, so I can write it as q upon 4 pi epsilon naught into x upon x square plus y square plus z square, square root it was power cube, so it will be, can be written as power 3 by 2. Similarly ey, you have to simply replace x by y. For ez, you have to replace it by z only. Once you have done for the electric field due to a point charge, you can write it for the n charges also. If I am having n source charges with me, then I want to find the electric field at any point, P point here. Then I have to take the vector sum of the electric field due to all other charges. Like for Q1, it is E1, for Q2 it is E2, for Q3 it is E3, for Q4 it is E4. And here you can take the position displacement vectors or position vectors, you may term it. This is simply the distance between the charge and the point P here. This is the point P where I want to find the electric field due to all these source charges. So according to superposition principle, when I am taking Q1 and Q0, then other charges are not affecting. Similarly, when I take Q3 and P, other are not affecting. And then I will take the vector sum of all the fields. Like we have taken vector sum of all the forces, here we need to take vector sum of all the fields. So you can write the expressions as you have done in the previous chapter. That is, you can write the E1. Here it will come in terms of Q1 because Q0 will get cancelled. I can simply write now in place of writing forces again and again, I can simply write for E1 and Q0 will get cancelled. I will write it 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. Of course, in general, we take the medium as air or vacuum only. So most of the times we talk about the epsilon naught. But if in some question they have specified you are working with some medium, then you have to replace epsilon naught by epsilon. And epsilon will be equals to epsilon naught epsilon r. So you can write the E1, you can write the E2 as well, which will be given by for Q2. That will be equals to Q2 4 pi epsilon naught R21 square and R2P unit vector. This is again we are writing in terms of unit vector. If we want to write in terms of given vector, we can again write whatever way it is required. We can always transform the equation. So you can write the total electric field by taking the vector sum of E1, E2, E3, so on. In terms of unit vector, we are getting this value. Here I is varying from 1 to n. So this is the expression for the electric field. Of course, it's a vector quantity and the direction of the resultant vector will be given. To give you the direction of the electric field at any point due to n charges, similar to the electric force, but then you have to find the values, magnitudes. Now the thing is, if the charges are not point charges, rather there is a continuous charge distribution of there. Means along the line the charge is distributed continuously. It means number of, we are not talking about the point charges. We are talking about the continuous charge distribution now. So continuous charge distribution, it means charge is uniformly distributed over the conductor. It means I can say there are infinite number of charges and they are very closely packed. In between there is no gap. That type of distribution we call it as the continuous charge distribution. Continuous charge distribution where the charge is uniformly distributed over the conductor. And infinite number of charges are there which are closely packed. So this uniform charge distribution, which I am calling it as the continuous charge distribution, it can be of three types. One is linear charge distribution, then I may say surface charge distribution, or along the volume the charge can be distributed. It means it can be distributed along the line, along the surface, or along the volume. So first of all, we are taking linear charge distribution. Linear charge distribution means the distribution is of charge is uniformly distributed along a line or along a straight line, I may say. Here we have to introduce few more terms with you. Like for linear charge distribution, you should be knowing what is linear charge density. Linear charge density, it is represented by lambda and it is equals to charge per unit length. So dq upon dl, or you can simply say q upon l. So it is q upon l, so unit will be coulomb per meter. You have to keep these terms in mind. One is linear charge density, which is denoted by lambda. It can be written as dq by dl, and the units are coulomb per meter. Like here in the diagram, we have shown a straight line, or it can be any line around which the charge is distributed. This line, it can be curved, it can be straight. So this line L is there. Here at P point, I want to find the field. Then I will be looking for the expression afterwards. But you should be knowing that lambda, it is equals to dq upon dl, coulomb per meter. For surface charge density, when the charge is distributed about the surface of the conductor, then the charge distribution is surface charge distribution. You can write surface charge distribution. And for surface charge distribution, we are defining the term surface charge density, that is sigma. Surface charge density sigma, that is again charge per unit area. That is charge per unit area. So it will be equals to sigma will be equals to dq upon area. Area means delta S you may write, or delta A you may write. So unit will be coulomb per meter square. Coulomb per meter square. Of course you can write the dimensions also. For charge it is AT upon and L minus 2. L minus 2 AT. Similarly, if the charge is distributed about the volume, around the volume I can say, then this term with us is volume charge density. Volume charge density is the term with me, which is denoted by rho, and it is equals to charge per unit volume. Charge per unit volume. And of course units will be coulomb per meter cube. And if you want to find the dimensional formula for the volume charge density, again you can write L minus 3 AT. So for any quantity you come across, you should be able to write the units and dimensional formula. So these are the three quantities with us: linear charge density, surface charge density, and volume charge density. The forces first, to understand the forces for the continuous charge distribution. Then if force is clear, you can write field also, simply divided by Q naught. Direction of force and field has to be the same. For surface charge distribution, if I want to take any surface, the small area is to be taken. ds here I have taken the small area. Then dq can be written as sigma ds, because sigma it is equals to charge per unit area. It means dq upon ds. Sigma is dq upon ds. So I can write dq equals to sigma ds. So you can write the small amount of force which will be acting at this test charge q naught, that is equals to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught q naught dq upon r square. So F, total force can be written by taking the integration of df, and you can write it in the integration form is to be taken. Integration is to be taken over the area. So I can write here S, like I have written L for the linear charge distribution. So that is simply to say that I am taking the integration over the surface, or I am taking the integration over the length. So this was about the surface charge distribution. Similarly, if you go with the volume charge distribution, you have to take a small volume from the surface, from the given shape of the conductor. So rho, your volume charge density is dq upon dv. If I am willing to find the force again at q naught, then I can write the force as the integration of df. Df, of course, you can write now, that is equals to q naught upon 4 pi epsilon naught integration over the volume rho r square dv, and r cap is simply to show the direction of the force. Most of the times when we talk about the electric field, we are having the conductor bodies with us. We talk about the volume. So in that case, you can write the electric field due to the volume charge distribution, which will be given by F upon Q naught. So of course, Q naught is to be cancelled, and I am left with 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught integration of rho dv upon r square r cap. This is the electric field due to the volume charge distribution. So we will be keeping the things up to this for today. Next, we will continue in the coming classes. Thank you.